All right. Good evening, everyone. Good to see you out for midweek prayer service and Master Club. If you would, grab a blue hymnal. Let's turn to page number 292. What she's playing, Surely Goodness and Mercy. Number 292.
A pilgrim was I and a wandering, and the cold night of sin I did roam. Jesus, the kind shepherd, found me, and now I am on my way home. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. He restoreth my soul when I'm weary. He giveth me strength day by day. He leads me beside the still waters. He guided me step on the way. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. When I walk through the dark, lonesome valley, my Savior walk with me there. And Satan is great and will lead me to the mansions he want to prepare. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever, and I shall feast at the table spread for me. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. All the days of my life.
All right, Master Club, you are dismissed. And everyone else, please turn to 481. 481. Sunlight.
I wandered in the shades of night. Jesus came to me, and with the sunlight of his love made all my darkness flee. Sunlight, sunlight on my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, I am at the sunlight of his love within. The clouds may gather in the sky and billows run, however dark the world may be, I've sunlight in my soul. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of his love within. While walking in the light of God, I sweet communion find. I press with holy vigor on and leave the world behind. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight. within. I cross the wide extended fields, I journey o'er the plain, and in the sunlight of His love I reap the golden grain. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of His love within. Soon I shall see Him as He is, the light that came to me, and fill the witness of His place throughout eternity. Sunlight, sunlight in my soul today. Sunlight, sunlight all along the way. Since the Savior found me, took away my sin, I have had the sunlight of His love within.
And 329, sitting at the feet of Jesus. 329.
Sitting at the feet of Jesus, oh, what words I hear Him say. Happy place, so sweet and precious, may I find it every day. Sitting at the feet of Jesus, I would look upon the past, for His love has been so gracious, it has won my heart at last. Sitting at the feet of Jesus, where can mortal be more blessed? There I lay my sins and sorrows, and where weary finds sweet rest. Sitting at the feet of Jesus, there I love to weep and pray. While I from His fullness gather grace and comfort every day. Bless me, O my Savior, bless me as I sit low at Thy feet. Oh, look down in love upon me, let me see Thy face so sweet. Give me, Lord, the mind of Jesus, make me holy as He is. May I prove I've been with Jesus, who is all my righteousness.
Amen to that. Thank you. Can be seated. That hymn, it says, was written by source unknown, but somebody knew the Lord that wrote that, I'd say that. Good to see each one of you tonight, midweek service. Hope your week is starting well and going well. We've got a lot of folks to pray about. Thank you for all the prayers for many of our folks, some having surgery and procedures this week, and they all went well. Thank you for praying for folks. We'll be able to sit at the feet of Jesus a little bit tonight and talk to Him about other needs that we might have. But first, don't forget to be praying for all of the, or remembering all the announcements that we have. This Saturday, there'll be a time for our teenagers to be bold for the Lord and not be ashamed of Jesus and His Word. And so they'll be holding scripture signs. That activity's at 10:30 this Saturday. So parents, teens, be in mind of that. If you need more information, you can see Brother Benjamin, Miss Hannah about that. And then also our services, be much in prayer that God would bless our services this Sunday, and that all who are with us will get what they need from the Lord. We will be having Brother Beam Gimire, I don't know if that's the way you say that, but that's his That's our missionary to Nepal that'll be with us during the Sunday evening service. His wife won't get to be with us, but she's doing well after her surgery. But we're glad that he'll be able to come and tell us of the work to Nepal, though we missed the missions conference. And there is the box on the back table. That will be for his wife. And so after the Sunday morning service, we'll take that away. If you've just give you opportunity, some have asked about wanting to give to her because she missed out on that during the missions conference. So that's back there in the back. Also, other things on the calendar, men and sons meeting, that's April the 4th, 5th and 6th in Ragland, Alabama. Also, other evangelistic opportunities to get out the gospel, one in Columbia, Tennessee, one in Fayetteville, Tennessee. And both are public events. The April the 6th is Mule Day in Columbia, and the church vans will depart at 9 a.m. And or you can meet us up there, and we'll give out gospel tracts and be a witness for the Lord together. Also, Fayetteville, Tennessee, the Slawburger Festival, April the 20th, and we'll do the same there to try to reach others with the gospel. So don't forget these events. And then also, Rocket City Youth Conference, April 26th, 27th. There's more information on the back wall there if you'd like, if you need more information about that activity. Thank you for praying for Miss Becky Kaufman, Miss Beverly Jones, those surgeries they had on Tuesday. And both are home and are doing well, and good reports coming out of both of their surgeries from their doctors. And the families just wanted me to say thank you for that. And Jack Randall, he came through his procedure well also, so thank you for praying for him. And then some of you got the prayer chain. They're not here tonight, but Miss Deanie Stark fell, and I don't think anything's broken, but if you could pray for her as they're trying to get her to recuperate and see what all happened there. So pray for Miss Deanie, if you will. Also, my uncle Jimmy is having some surgery upcoming. Appreciate your prayers for him. And then any other prayer requests that you have tonight, let us know about it, and we will definitely talk to the Lord about it. Anybody tonight? Yes, sir, Brother Bob. Okay, open heart surgery, friend of Brother Bob's, Lee Massey. Let's pray for this request. Somebody else tonight? Yes, sir.
Pray for the Couch family. That's my first cousin, third degree.
So Brother Jimmy's first cousin passed away, so pray for the Couch family, please, bereavement. Someone else? Yes, Benjamin. Okay, pray for the Doucettes going to Papua New Guinea for 2 weeks. Taking all those instruments. That's going to be an event there. By the way, they've already signed up to go with us to Greece whenever we do that, and hopefully 2025. And so they'll all be on the streets playing music. We'll get us a crowd there. Somebody else? Yes, sir, Brother Mark. All right, Brother Mark, we will pray for his house to sell. Yes, Miss Paula. All right, Joanna Holt with surgery. That was today. Okay. Somebody else? Brother Schott. Amen. Let's keep praying for Brother Gary. They're just eliminating one thing after another, hadn't found what's going on with his health. So let's pray for Brother Schott. Yes, Miss Lynette. Okay, Brother Ted and Miss Lynn's son. His name's Jeremy? Okay. Having a lot of health problems. Yes. Okay, Angela Owens with COVID. Also, Brother Jerry Morse, he texted me today, he's got bronchitis, so that's why they're not here tonight. I saw another hand. Yes, sir, Simon.
My brother-in-law, Shelton, he's having a biopsy on his throat. There's a lot of swelling and stuff going on.
Okay, Simon's brother-in-law, Shelton, with a biopsy. Anybody else? Yes, I'm sorry, Miss Miranda. Yes, ma'am. Let's pray for Miss Miranda's unspoken. Yes, sir, Brother Trinkle.
Appreciate the church and pray for God's wisdom about moving my mother here.
Absolutely. Pray for his mother's situation and moving her here. Someone else. Anybody? All right, we've got enough to pray about. So you that would you gather with me around the altar and we'll pray for these needs. And Benjamin, just play something for us, would you? And we'll pray together.
God can hear us as we pray. Certainly need his help.
Thank you.
Well, thank God for a good time of prayer. Let's take our Bibles together now and go back to the prophet Micah as we've been looking at what Isaiah's buddy preached that nobody remembers. How would you like to grow up in Isaiah's shadow? Oh, you were a prophet when Isaiah was a prophet. Oh, okay. Well, we know Isaiah, but who are you? He wrote 66 chapters. How many did you get, Micah? But yet, just as surely the Word of God as anything Isaiah ever said. So tonight's message, if you saw that in the bulletin, the title, we're starting a new chapter in the book of Micah. We're in chapter 3. And I've told you, if you have a Cambridge Bible, you don't have to have a Cambridge Bible. They're all King James. I'm talking about the maker of the notes and all of that. But the Cambridge Bible will show you where the paragraphs are by this little backwards P at the beginning of the verses. So from verse number 1 to verse number 4 is one paragraph. Verse number 5 to verse number 7 is another paragraph. And then verse 8 to the end of the chapter there. That's how the third chapter of Micah is broken up. In the first four verses, he will address the princes of Israel. Those are those people in positions of authority. In verse 5, 6, and 7, he addresses the prophets of Israel. And then in verse 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, he's going to sort of just go over all of those and include the priests as well in that group. So that's how chapter 3 breaks up. In your bulletin, I said the title of the message tonight as we go through the Word of God together is Cannibalism. Now, that's not clickbait, if you know what that is. That's not just get somebody to click on the message and listen to it. Because it is what is discussed in the text in the first four verses. Now, whether it's discussing physical cannibalism or not, it's going to open up a big conversation that we need to have. And I would say this, you know, every generation of man is getting darker and darker. It's like people just try to figure out what thing can I do that's just worse? How can I one up the generation before and do something that's a little more extreme? And certainly cannibalism would fall into that. So, you know, I'd say most of you will breathe a sigh of relief, say, at least I won't be convicted tonight. But you never can tell. So let's just read these first four verses. Micah chapter 3, verse number 1. Finally, a message I don't have to go to the altar for, Lord. Micah chapter 3, verse 1, and I said, "Hear, I pray you, O heads of Jacob, and ye princes of the house of Israel." So he's speaking to the rulers of the nation, you understand. "Is it not for you to know judgment, who hate the good and love the evil, who pluck off their skin from off them and their flesh from off their bones, who also eat the flesh of my people and flay their skin from off them, and they break their bones and chop them in pieces as for the pot and as flesh within the cauldron." I think you can see why we're going there with the phrase of cannibalism. Verse number 4, "Then shall they cry unto the Lord, but he will not hear them. He will even hide his face from them at that time, as they have behaved themselves ill in their doings." So this message is against the rulers the preaching against the rulers. You know, a good prophet's going to cover every type of individual, going to bring the word of God to every group of people. And I'd say if anybody needs to hear the preaching of the word of God, it would be the people that are in position of authority, because it affects everybody underneath their authority. And so the prophet begins preaching to the rulers of Israel, the heads, verse 1, of Jacob, the princes of the house of Israel. And he says three things about them. The first thing he says about them in verse number 1, really it's a question, is it not for you to know judgment? The first thing he says about the rulers is that you people don't know judgment. You're in charge of the country, but you don't know what you're doing. You are in the position of authority, but you do not understand what justice is and what judgment is. And the whole nation is suffering because you don't know how to be the judge of the people. You do not know how to put God's authority in their lives, in the life of the nation. The second thing he says about them, in verse number 2, he says that they hate the good and love the evil. So the first comment, you don't know judgment. The second comment, you actually hate the good and you love the evil. And then the third thing he says to them, and you I don't know how else you can degrade someone. He basically just calls them cannibals. You are feeding on the people of God. You are feasting on them. You are consuming them. And so those are the things we want to look at. By the way, I looked at chapter 3, and there's a lot of negativity in chapter 3. But, you know, the Lord says, just hold on. You get to chapter 4 and chapter 5, and everything's better. So that's the way you got to do with God. You just got to buckle up for what he wants to say. It'll get better the longer the meal goes. Dessert is at the end. The sweet things are at the end. And so right now we've got some things to chew on. So, yeah, he talks about the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ, the great kingdom the Lord will set up in chapter 4, chapter 5. I look forward to getting into that. But right now the nation is suffering. And one of the reasons they're suffering is because of the rulers that they have. And I would like to make that practical application to any nation, including our own. God has given this nation rulers that suit our own sins. That's why we have anemic leadership and people that don't know where they are, because the nation doesn't know where the nation is. The nation is totally blind and has no understanding. So all that is just a reflection of the nation. But let's look at these three things together. Verse number 1, he says, and I said, here I pray you, O heads of Jacob and you princes of the house of Israel, is it not for you to know judgment? Micah is saying this: if anybody ought to know the law and ought to know judgment and be putting justice into action, it's the people that are in authority to do that. The whole reason people are given authority is so that the children will not be in charge. Does that make sense? Somebody that's been put in a place of authority is supposed to keep things under control and keep things in line. You know, we would not want to put somebody in charge of a junior class or a teen class that just wants to be everybody's buddy. You understand? Because if you do that, then it's just, you know, no holds barred. You put adults in charge. Amen. Right? So here's my question. Here was Micah's question. Where are the adults? Our nation, he's saying, the nation of Israel is being run by people who do not know judgment. They don't know how to correct anybody. They don't know how to put restrictions on anybody. They don't know how to enforce the law. They don't know how to keep everything going in a proper functioning way. They're rulers of the people. But isn't that your job, to know judgment? And you don't know judgment. You don't even know who to judge.
And you're not even judging rightly. That'll lead into the second thing he says about them. If anybody is supposed to know the law, it's supposed to be the judge. If the judge doesn't respect the law, what's going to happen in the courtroom? And that's the position they're in. They've got a country being run by people that do not know judgment or justice, and everything is falling apart. Does it sound familiar to you? The people that are in control, in authority, are supposed to be the ones that have their pulse and their hand on the issues and the problems and are enacting the justice and the judgment that's needed to keep society in control. And that's exactly the opposite of what is happening in Israel here in Micah chapter 3, and the exact opposite of what's happening in our country. So instead of a child being at fault, the justice system is saying that the parents are at fault for disciplining the child. That's the nation's society. We live in a society where the people that are in authority do not even understand justice and judgment, and that puts us all at risk. I mean, from the top to the bottom of society. I mean, if you are a person in leadership, if you have a governmental office or a judicial office, and you don't know, and you think that it is okay to give hormones to a minor to keep their normal, natural puberty functionings from happening, that is so unjust, so unnatural. So that's child abuse. But those same people that'll say, if you spank your child, you're the child abuser. The same judges that would say you can go ahead and do surgeries to alter the body of a minor would be the same person that would say that what we're doing trying to train our children should be against the law. That's exactly the society we live in. People that are in authority that do not know judgment. And somebody wrote an article over in Europe, in the UK, saying history is going to look back on this generation, and they're going to look at all these things the medical community and the scientific community and the governmental community is doing with the children of this generation, and they're going to say that this is going to be the awfulest abuse of children in history. They said that history is going to look back on that. But you'd think a judge would understand that. Now, a brain-dead parent that just gives in to his child every time the child comes to them, maybe you could say, all right, I understand how you know, you've missed the ball. Anytime your child ever asks you for anything, you just give in. So if they come in and say they're a boy instead of a girl, you just give in. But you don't expect that from a judge. Right. You expect the judge to know judgment. That's his job. That's why he's there. And yet they do not know judgment. They'll kill unborn babies and say that's fine. And then they'll put you in jail. They'll put you in jail if you kill a dog. They'll put you in jail if you kill a dog. I mean, in jail. That is people that are in charge in a godless society. And that's what Micah's talking about all the way back here in Micah chapter 3. You people are supposed to know judgment. You don't know judgment. That's the whole reason you're there. You know, today, guys, criminals have more rights than people defending their own homes. And it's because the people that are in charge don't know judgment. They'll judge the police officer instead of the drug addict. They will. They'll judge you for defending your home instead of judging the person that's breaking in your home. I never forget, I had that conversation with our Commonwealth attorney when I lived in Virginia and had that incident when I went out of town, and it was just harassment stuff, people, you know, persecuting us and tried to break in my house while I was on a mission trip and all that. And I got with the Commonwealth attorney. I said, you know what? If somebody tries to break in my house, I'm going to kill them. And he said, He said, well, just make sure that they stay on your property. Now this was back in the 90s. I said, if they come to the door, I'm just going to shoot them right through the door. He said, that's probably not the best. I said, it may not be the best, but that's happening. He said, well, then please open the door and pull them inside. Because I don't want any problem, he said. But at least that guy knew judgment. You can't even have a conversation like that now. Instead of citizens having rights, illegal people have more rights than citizens have. Why? Because the rulers of the people do not know judgment. They don't know how to make any determination of what is right and wrong, what is just and what is unjust. Prosecuting self-defenders, prosecuting parents, prosecuting people of religion. Guys, do you know it wasn't long ago on the books, it was a crime to commit an act of sodomy? A crime. And now it's fast becoming a crime to say it is a crime. You see how the thing is flipped? Because there's no longer judgment or justice in the land. I personally think, and I'm not worried about it, I'm not up in arms about it, because my faith is in the Lord, my faith is in the coming of the Lord. I know He's got power to protect us, and I pray to that end, but I have no confidence in any form of authority in this nation. I have really none, not at all. I don't believe the elections are fair. I don't believe the justice system is fair. I wouldn't trust my life in front of a judge or a jury in this country for anything if I had to. Because justice is not in the land. Judgment is not here. That is nothing new. That's right what's happening. But let's get a few verses on that before I get to the second point. Go to Isaiah, Micah's buddy. He's sort of preaching the same thing in Isaiah chapter 59. So get Isaiah 59, and then with your other hand get Isaiah chapter 9. These two preachers, that you know that they were in tune with God. They're preaching the same messages. They got the same kind of heartbeat, and God's giving them the same things. And you ought to be able to recognize and spot God-called people, because God's not going to have conflicting message to the generation, you see. And so He's not having a conflicting message. Both Isaiah and Micah, they're plowing the same row. In Isaiah chapter 59, watch it. He says in verse number 3, Isaiah 59:3, for your hands are defiled with blood, and your fingers with iniquity, your lips have spoken lies, your tongue hath muttered perverseness. Watch it, verse 4. None calleth for justice. You see that? Nor any pleadeth for truth. They trust in vanity and speak lies. They conceive mischief and bring forth iniquity. Drop down to verse number 12. For our transgressions are multiplied before thee, and our sins testify against us, for our transgressions are with us. And as for our iniquities, we know them. Verse 13, in transgressing and lying against the Lord and departing away from our God, speaking oppression and revolt, conceiving and uttering from the heart words of falsehood. Watch verse 14. And judgment is turned away backward. Everything's backward. Judgment is turned away backward, and justice standeth afar off. In other words, the judgment, the justice is not there. Why? Look, keep reading, verse 14. For truth is fallen in the street. That's the United States of America. And equity cannot enter. Yea, truth faileth, and he that departeth from evil maketh himself a prey. He said the people that are trying to get away from evil, they're the ones that people are preying on. Watch it. And the Lord saw it. You see that? The Lord saw it, and it displeased him, look at it, that there was no judgment. You see that? There's a lot of injustices in the land, but you know, America was founded on trying to have a haven from the injustices of the world. That's why our nation came to be existing. Because people wanted to go to a place where they could worship God freely without being put in jail for what they believed. And they wanted a break from the people that were putting them under their thumb and taking their money and unjustly controlling their lives. So they threw all the tea in the harbor. Yeah. Do you know, guys, do you know why Americans don't do like the Brits? You know, if you go to England today, all these English people, they all do it. All of them have tea. They get up in the morning, they have tea. Then they have afternoon tea. Do you know that used to be what America did? Now watch this. Guys, you know what? Something we don't even understand our own history. Why don't we drink tea? You know, during the Revolutionary War, Americans says, I'll tell you one thing, we're not drinking no more tea. You can take your tea and shove it. And Americans quit drinking tea. So they start drinking coffee. And to this day, British people are tea drinkers and Americans are coffee drinkers. You know why? Because Americans says, you're not going to keep treading on me. We want a land that has judgment and justice. We don't want this oppression. And now we're coming full circle all the way back around. Only problem is we ain't got no tea to throw in the harbor. But what we do have to look forward to, look at chapter 9. I love this. Isaiah said, you rulers, you just go ahead, but your time is running out. Because you're not going to rule forever. Amen. Amen. The only good thing about the person in the White House, he can't be there too much longer. No matter how you shake it. Amen. It's going to run out. And all the tenure of these rulers is going to run out. He said in Isaiah chapter 9, and this is what's going to run out, period. He said in chapter 9, verse number 6, Amen, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government, amen, shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. That's somebody you want in charge of the government. We've never had a president that we can step back and say, Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God. We never had a ruler like that. But he's coming. Look at verse number seven. Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be, watch it, no end. Upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom to order it. Watch it now. That's why I went here. And to establish it with what? Judgment and with what? With justice from henceforth even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this. There will be no vote. There will be no, it will not be up for discussion. God says my zeal is going to perform this. I'm going to do this. And then there'll finally be justice. And there'll finally be judgment. All the world would want Jesus to come right now and take over. First thing he'd do, he'd shut all their bars down. Then he'd shut all their theaters down. I got less of an amen on that. He would. He'd shut down all the pornography industry. It would be illegal. He'd take all the bad magazines out of the stores. He'd fire Google. He would destroy TikTok. He would have YouTube broadcast the Word of God 24 hours a day. Because now the one that's in charge that knows how to run things will be in charge. Yeah. And there'll be judgment and justice. So as bad as our rulers get, we need to keep our eyes on the prize. And I think the false hope is, well, if we get somebody in there that's pretty good. This is a broken system. And we need God's child to come fix it.
Amen.
Unto us a child is born. So the first thing, they don't know judgment. The second thing, Micah chapter 3, verse 2. What a commentary. Who hate the good and love the evil. That's one person you don't want being your judge. Who hates good and loves evil. That's one thing you do not want in a ruler.
Right.
And that's what we have. I never forget when I went years and years ago. I don't even know when it was. I was a child or maybe when I was in my 20s. But it was when they were still giving tours of the White House. I don't even know if they still do that anymore. Anyway, so we were going through there. And I saw, and the tour guide gave a little explanation of a big plaque that's on the outside of the White House that John Adams put there. John Adams was a good man. And John Quincy Adams, his boy, was even a better man. Both presidents. And John Adams, when he left, he put on the White House, and it's still there. And I won't get it quoted just right, but he said something to the effect that, may only good men and just men rule within this house. And every time our perverted presidents and leaders walk in that building, I wish that plaque would jump in their brain. Because we used to have some good men. But now we've got people who hate the good and love the evil. Hate the Bible and Bible-believing families. And love the sodomites and the transgenders and all the other wickedness in the society. You do know you're hated, don't you? This book is hated. Guys, Mule Day, Slawburger Day, even though Tennessee is conservative. We could go down there with shirts with rainbows and statements about homosexuality, and nobody probably would say a word to us. We go down there with the gospel, and I guarantee you somebody will say something. You know why? We live in a day where they hate the good and they love the evil. Almost reminds me of children, you know. Children growing up, they'll pass on the green beans and amen, the broccoli and the steak, that they want chicken nuggets. And you can sit a child down and say, now you know that is not a piece of chicken. You know half of that is plastic. It's pink fluff. Let me tell you what's in that. No, 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 I want this. Kids today would much rather eat junk food and stuff that's bad for you than eat things that are healthy. Ew, what is that? And so they come in church as adults. And they hear the word of God and they say, ooh, what is that? And they hear, sitting at the feet of Jesus. And they're bored. I don't like that music. And then they go across town, some liberal, lift him up, up, up. Oh, yeah, we like that, man. Yeah. Hate the good, love the evil. What kind of church y'all have? Well, we get down and pray. Y'all have a coffee shop? Y'all got yoga classes? What's that church? Inspirational dance classes? I'm telling you, we live in a generation. And it's bad enough just when common people that way. But when the people that are in authority, when the pastors of our churches and the governors and senators of our states and the leaders of our schools and the heads of our houses, when they hate the good and they love the evil, judgment is upon us. So that's the commentary. And so then he goes into the cannibalism stuff. And so that's why they tuned in. So we'll go there. Verse number 2. Who hate the good and love the evil, who pluck off their skin from off them. Well, that's pretty gross. Pretty graphic thing for a preacher to preach. Who pluck off their skin from off them and their flesh from off their bones. Who also eat the flesh of my people. And flay their skin from off them. And they break their bones and chop them in pieces as for the pot. And as flesh within the cauldron. He goes into this graphic discussion of how these rulers are responsible for the total consuming of the people of God. They do not just kill them and eat their flesh, but and pluck off their flesh, but they flay it off. You know, you guys that have flayed a fish or a deer, something, you're getting the meat all the way off to the bone, and you're just leaving the bones. And he said, you're so skilled that you're taking all the meat of the people all the way to their very bones, and you're taking that off of them and their flesh. And then he says, then you take their bones. You're not content just with their flesh. You take their bones and you chop up their bones and you put them in the pot and you feed on them. Now, of course, some of you know that know anything about cooking, you know the most of the time the good part's next to the bone. And the really good part, if you've ever had bone marrow, but I won't go into that. Some of you might freak out on that, but it's like butter. And that's all right with a cow. He says, you're doing this with people. You are totally consuming every piece of them. You're a bunch of cannibals. That's what he's saying to them. You've oppressed them and confiscated their stuff and taken their everything about them, even to their own children and their own homes and their own innocence and the truth away from them. And you've oppressed them and taken their goods away from them. I mean, you have just totally consumed every part of the people of God. And I'd say this, that's the devil. The devil just didn't want to hurt your kids. He wants to consume you all the way down to your bones. He wants to destroy not just your marriage, not just your sanity, not just your innocence. No, he wants to totally consume us, like chopping us up and put us in a pot. He wants to totally consume our churches. He wants to totally do away with everything so that there's not even a trace of what we are or what we were. That's why they're trying to erase our Christian heritage. They've already erased much of our Southern heritage. And I think they're going to try to erase our American heritage. I think they're just trying to erase everything until we're totally consumed and there's nothing left of us but a big pile of soup bones. He said, you guys are a bunch of cannibals. But that shouldn't surprise you. You do know cannibalism is on the rise, don't you? Now, this is a little weird, but if you think the Bible's not up to date, you're wrong. CNN did an article. It said 2022 is the year of the cannibal. I'm talking about real cannibalism. There were two popular movies. One was called Fresh. One was called Bones and All. They got a bunch of awards. You know what they were about? Cannibalism. People traveling the country and eating people. And they got good reviews. But that shouldn't be too shocking to you, because we've been watching and hearing about blood-eating vampires for forever. All a vampire is a cannibal. He's just cannibalizing the blood instead of the flesh.
Yep, that's right.
And is that not a popular thing in society?
Right.
Do you know there are young people that want to know what blood tastes like? You know there's even a movement on the internet. I can't get too far into this because it's so dark and wicked and depraved and satanic. The people are wondering what human flesh tastes like. Guys, here's the deal. When you forsake God, there is no limit to what you're going to be capable of doing. There are no limits. By the way, which is why half of the sodomite serial killers were cannibals. That's fact. February 14, 2024. Is that close enough? Here's the magazine called The New Scientist. The title of the article, "Is It Time for a More Subtle View on the Ultimate Taboo, Cannibalism?" Listen to this. If a body can be bequeathed with consent to medical science, why can't it be left to feed the hungry? I'm reading from the article. Our aversion to this has been explained in various ways. Our aversion to this? Perhaps it's down to the fact that it's Western religious tradition. In other words, the reason we don't eat dead bodies is just because of all this Western religion that we have. You better thank God for that.
Amen.
Or they'll be like the freak over there in California that was just on the news yesterday or the other day that took a dead guy's leg off the train track and was eating on it in California.
Yeah.
That was this week. Perhaps it's down to the fact that in Western religious tradition, or maybe it's culturally ingrained. I tell you what's wrong with our society is it's just cultural. No, the reason that we don't eat people is not cultural. You see what whacked out people we have, satanic people? It's just cultural. The reason you people don't agree with same-sex marriage, it's just a cultural problem. Which is the same reason you don't eat people. Oh, wow. Brother Roloff was right. Back to the Bible or back to the jungle, buddy. You know the people that ate people? They're in Indonesia. They got bones through their nose. That's what we got running our country. Our revulsion towards cannibalism became a tenet of our moral conscience. In other words, the only reason we don't eat people is because Western religion has given us a moral conscience to tell us not to do it. And what they're trying to do is they're trying to take our conscience away from everything. So we don't have a conscience no more. And so then you know what you have? You have cannibalism. That happened. Look, he's talking. I know how he's talking here in Micah chapter 3. But you know what the reference is really going to? In the nation of Israel, they really did start eating people. I mean, one of the most famous stories is in 2 Kings. 2 Kings chapter 6. They had a famine. It was a great famine. And the first thing they started eating was an ass's head. The second thing they ate was dove's dung. And the third thing they ate, they started eating their own babies. Remember that? The woman came in, the king got so mad because she said, we boiled my son yesterday and ate him, and we're supposed to boil her son. That happened in the nation of Israel. By the way, with this type of society with no moral conscience and no God, when famine hits this land, what do you think this society will do? Famine can come like that. And it is coming. The book of Revelation tells us that black horse in the tribulation, when it gets here, and praise God, I'll sing with Brother Earl, but I'll be gone. Yes, I'll be. When you guys are eating your babies, I'm going to be gone. But that's going to happen all over again. And that's why it's even being desensitized even now in our society and in our culture. By the way, don't you think it's a little satanic, demonic, that when Stephen the preacher was preaching, they ran on him, and the Bible says they gnashed on him with their teeth? Looks like a bunch of cannibals to me. By the way, you know what that's what they do in hell? They gnash with their teeth. Well, I didn't know I was going to go all this far with all this, but anyway, that's real cannibalism. There's also what I would call generational cannibalism. That's one generation consuming the next, destroying the next generation below us. And there's a variety of ways to do it, stealing the truth and our biblical traditions away from them. But I think sometimes a previous generation will consume the next, just like there's a group of animals that consume their young. It's all weird, but they're animals. You know, you've heard of dog eat dog, you know. I mean, that phrase is the reason for that phrase. You know, people can consume their children. You know, the worst thing you can do for your child is you try to live vicariously through them and try to get them to do all the things that you didn't get to do. That's just feeding on your own child. It's like the lady that wants her, since she could never do it, wanting little Susie to be the beauty queen and the cheerleader that she could never be. And guys, you know what the best thing we do with our children? Just tell them, hey, you need to do whatever the will of God is for your life. I'm not going to feed on your life. That's another sermon, but we need to let them grow and shine and go for God, man. Not feed on them. Galatians 3:15, you knew it, I'd have to go here. I'm getting close to finishing, but hurry, go with me. Galatians 3:15. Here's a type of cannibalism that we do commit as Christians. And while you turn over to Galatians 3, I give you another one while you're turning. A religious cannibalism. That's what's going to happen this Sunday. Mena, mena, mena. Behold the body of Jesus. Whosoever eateth his flesh, take the wafer. And as you're eating the wafer, you're really eating the body of Jesus. You know what I say? I say, I don't eat people. That's Roman Catholicism. That's Orthodox Church. That's saying that communion is literally that the cup turns into the blood of Jesus. If it does, you better not drink it. The book says don't be drinking people's blood. But here, Galatians chapter 5, real chapter 3, I'm sorry. Galatians 3, verse 15. Brethren, I speak after the manner of men. That's not what I want. Maybe it's 4:15. Yeah. That ain't it either. I'm looking for, if you bite and devour one another. 5:15. Well, okay, the next chapter. Galatians chapter 5, verse 15. But if you bite and devour one another,
take heed that ye be not consumed one of another. You see, that's cannibalism. Don't eat each other up with your words, with your arguments, with your strife, with your fights, with your bitterness. Some families consume their own family. Marriages consume their own marriage. I've known churches that consumed their own church, and when they got through with it, there was nothing left of it. He says, don't eat each other till you consume each other. Be kind. Be nice to each other. Don't be a bunch of cannibals. Sheep don't eat meat. They don't eat other animals. Wolves eat animals. Dogs eat. But we're sheep. We're just supposed to get there and roll around. You ever seen little lambs jump up and down? It's a beautiful thing. You ever seen them get down on their knees and eat? Watching sheep, so beautiful. They don't go around eating each other. Don't bite other people. Quit biting people. Well, I'm finished. Last verse. Micah chapter 3, verse 4. We didn't read it. So this is what God says. Because you guys are a bunch of cannibals. He said in verse number 4 of Micah chapter 3. Then shall they cry unto the Lord, but he will not hear them. He will even hide his face from them at that time, as they have behaved themselves ill in their doings. What a message. When God won't hear. He said, you people are so depraved. When you call out to me, I'm not even going to hear you. Now, you know what you ought to thank the Lord tonight? That's not where you live. The Bible says today, if you'll hear his voice and harden not your heart, he's still listening. His eyes are over the righteous. His ears are open unto their prayers. Today is the day of salvation. He's still listening. All right, let's stand. Be dismissed in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for the good attention of your people tonight. Lord, we see the seriousness of the condition of our nation and of the world. And Father, you know we are powerless to do anything about it. But you didn't tell us to change the world. You told us to preach the gospel. And so Lord, help us to continue to give out the gospel and to do your will and your work. And we're trusting you for these things. We do pray as you told us to pray for all those in authority. Lord, I prayed for them tonight. You know, you heard it. I pray, Lord, that you would control their minds, that you would bring them back to the place of judgment and justice so that we could live a peaceable life and a quiet life in all godliness and honesty. We do pray for our rulers. We don't want to just throw eggs at them. We want to pray for them. And we pray, God, most of all, that you'd send forth your Son back into this world. We pray, even so, come quickly, Lord Jesus. We're waiting for the day the government will be on your shoulder. And we pray this in the name of Christ, expecting and believing and trusting that you'll be coming soon for your people. Keep us looking up, Lord, and we'll thank you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Dismissed.